All right. Good morning, Otter Creek. How's everybody doing? It is so good to see you. My name is David Rubio, and I am one of the ministers here. I am the director of the Otter Creek Youth Group. So I work with teenagers, and I'm excited to get a chance to welcome you this morning. If you are a visitor, then we hope you will give us a chance right after the service to welcome you, greet you, give you a high five or whatever. And if you're a first-time guest, we would love for you to come see the Welcome Center, which is out these back doors and just to the left. It's right on the other side of that column there, that brick column. We're really glad you're here. If you don't mind, I'd love to ask you at this time to grab the registry, the attendance registry that's on your pew there, and just pass it down. You can, you know, put your name in there if you like, but pass that down for us. Otter Creek is a church, is a family growing to become like Jesus. And we are really glad you're here with us today. We value our time together. And the fact that we may not know each other doesn't change the reality that we're family. And it's a pretty cool thing to be connected like this by our God in Christ. A couple of things that you need to know about, some special events that are happening here this week. Trunk or Treat is tonight. So make some noise if you're coming to Trunk or Treat. All right, now make some noise if you don't know what Trunk or Treat is. I was hoping someone would say, Trunk or Treat, we're going to have a demonstration. No, we're not. We're not really going to demonstrate Trunk or Treat. But this afternoon at 3:45, we're going to have lots of cars parked out here and minivans, and the OCYG will have a van parked out there, and we'll be dressed in costumes ourselves. And then you little ones, or little ones from the community, really any little one anywhere, or even a big one that just loves candy, can come out here, walk amongst the trunks, and receive some treats. Halloween, I tell you, getting candy for wearing a costume and trying to deceive other people into thinking I was somebody different than what I really was, that was like a magic trick when I was young. Get candy. It was all about candy. And so hopefully this afternoon, as a community, we can just really contribute to the future 401ks of the dentists in our community together. And also, we're doing something again this year that we've done in the past, and that is contributing to the neighbor kits. So we would love to provide some people with the items in these neighbor kits. So if you could bring a pair of new socks and a Clif Bar with you, we will throw it into the neighbor kits, and it will bless someone in need this holiday season. So remember to do that as well. And you can check out information relative to this on the website or any of our social media platforms. That's this afternoon. Cars need to be in place by 3:45. The event begins at 4. On Wednesday night this week, we are going to be doing, we think it's the 40th anniversary of the Parade of Bible Characters. Huh? The 40th anniversary of the Parade of Bible Characters. Now, we think that. We got brains coming together trying to be certain of this before we publish it. If not, it's the 35th anniversary, but who's counting? I guess I am. Anyway, we think it's the 40th, and we'll verify that. But Parade of Bible Characters is an event that's been obviously going on for a while, and it's a lot of fun. And if you don't know what it is, I'm going to show you what Parade of Bible Characters is like. Because I know, I've been emceeing Parade of Bible Characters now for about 12 years, I think. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 or 12 years. And we've never had a crowd quite this large, so I'm guessing some of you have never been. So here's how it works. It's a lot like a Halloween dress-up situation, just Bible character style. And I know you're still going, but what are you talking about? Hold on. Demonstration time. Do we have a children's minister in here? Because we always, a children's minister will step. Oh, Dawn, good. Dawn, come up here. And can we get Dawn a microphone? Oh, she's already got one. Great. How did that happen? Yeah, Dawn, what happens? Dawn will stand over here. Okay. And on Wednesday night, when you come at 7, children dressed in all manner of amazing costumes will be lined up down here. We obviously don't have them in place because they're not ready yet. They need several more days. They're going to come in a Bible costume with a note card in their hand. And it'll go something like this, okay? Are you ready? And action.
Okay, do we have our little person dressed up? Are you back
there? Oh, this should be fun. Let's see what happens next.
It's okay. Come on out. I know there's some people.
Now, if you know the answer already,
you can do it.
Don't shout it out.
Yeah, come on. Come on, little guy. It's okay. Yeah.
These kids
come
are sometimes
up here. No.
A little shy.
Come with me. Come with me. It's okay. I know. Do you have your clues? Okay. All right. Thank you.
Make sure he's got his clues.
He's got his
also,
clues.
Also, and is his name on the card? Because I would be embarrassed
yes.
if I forgot.
Yes, his name's on the card. Look at me. Look at me.
Come it's on okay. over here, buddy.
It's okay. Here you go. Take this and give it to Uncle David.
Come on.
No.
No.
There you go.
Who's got a hug for Uncle David?
Okay,
stand right here in the middle. Let me have your card. All right, now. You may already know who this is from the Bible, but you may not. So wait for the clues. Here we go. This is Kevin Colvett. Glad you're here, buddy. No, stay here. Stay here in the middle. All right. The invention of barbed wire hit my profession pretty hard. Okay. Clue number two. David, not Rubio, was a good one, and Jesus was the good one. Okay. Any guesses? No guesses? Okay. Number three. My LinkedIn profile includes above reproach, not given to much wine, and holds to the trustworthy word as taught so that I may, what does that say here? Be able to give instruction in sound doctrine. Oh, is this another clue? A fourth clue? Be able to give instruction. All while herding sheep. What am I?
Shepherd.
A shepherd. I'm a shepherd. Good job, Kevin. Hey.
Hey.
Good job.
Thank you, Kevin. You can go sit with your mom and dad now. You can go on down. Thank you. Let's hear it for Kevin Colvett. Parade of Bible Characters is this coming Wednesday night.
Good job.
Love to have you here. It's going to be a lot like this, only way cuter. And I promise you will learn something. Some of these kids will stump you. And now let's all stand together as we worship our God.
All right. Here we go, church. Clap our hands. We've got a lot to be joyful about this morning. Victorious.
justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
We trust.
Oh, we trust the name of
declare that.
Yeah.
please forgive us for when our heart sings of things other than you. Please forgive us for our selfishness, for how quick we are to wander and to lose our focus. But God, this morning we come together as a family to declare our prayer that our hearts would sing of your name, not our own, no one else's, but yours, God. Please help us live that out and breathe that this morning as we continue to praise you. We love you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the night. Then through the dark your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could
you're buried body began.
I'm always grateful for the change of the seasons. In each, I am mindful of the beauty and the absolute wonder of our Creator. Fall is one of my favorites. The respite of the heat and the splendor of the bold pops of color in great abundance. Our God loves to delight us, and He loves to do so in abundance. He told us that, in fact, in John. I have come to give you life, and life more abundantly. Abundant life means plentiful and great excess. It's not just one tree that changes colors, as if that would be mystery enough. It's hillsides and mountains. It's great abundance. As Josh spends some time today reflecting on the idols that we might be putting in our lives that cause us some distraction from this abundance, let us remember how God works to show us His majesty over the world. It refuses to be denied. We cannot expect for God to be our peace if the world is the source of our satisfaction. Let's come to the table to commune with our God, who provides for us in great abundance. Pray with me. Creator, as we still ourselves to commune with you, clear our minds, calm our spirits, focus our thoughts just on you. Bring us to your table of abundance. Feed us with your full sense of presence. Make our priorities the priorities you have for us, as our confidence is found in you and only you. In Jesus' name.
Simple faith to plunge in.
trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust the precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that Thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
One of the unexpected blessings that I've had over the last 30 years of my work has been to spend time with people who understand and experience the true joy of giving. And we say that a lot, but I truly encounter people who have really, truly experienced that. If you've traveled very much around this world, you realize that we are a very rich people. Every time I travel out of this country to a third world place, I'm reminded how blessed we are, so far beyond what we really need. But yet our hearts and our prayers so many times are focused on what we want and not what we really truly need. So I pray, and my prayer for myself and this church is that we will struggle with what we do with what we have. Because as Joshua reminded us this morning, and as Beth talked about in her comments this morning, there is abundance waiting for us that we are blocking because we have put idols in front of us. And one of those are the things that we have. But true joy from giving doesn't come from guilt. It comes from understanding the great gratitude, and we feel compelled to give because what God has done for us. So my challenge and encouragement for you is think about the many blessings you have and to understand fully that that's the source of all of that is God our Father who loves us, and that out of that we will be compelled to be generous in all of our life. Let's pray together. God, we pray that your blessings on this offering this morning. God, help us to more fully realize that you are the great giver, that you created all of this. And in our humanness, we want to accumulate, but you want us to release and to let go and to let you be God and to use the things we have to bring you glory, to expand your kingdom. God, I pray you'll bless these resources that are given even today, that they will be salt and light for your word, for your kingdom, in this place and many places around the world, so that you will be exalted, your kingdom will be expanded, and others will come to know you as Jesus, their personal Savior. We ask all of this in the blessed and holy name of Jesus and believe. Amen.
As we are receiving the offering, I just want to remind you, as you pray this week and write notes this week, remember those who have lost significant loved ones. I know Sandy Bledsoe and Rhonda Lowry and John McCaslin are three of those people. We were able to pray over John and Rhonda in the first worship gathering. Rhonda's mother, Phyllis, who was part of this church, Phyllis Appleby, she passed away earlier this week. And Gene McCaslin, who sat second row every first service for at least the last 9 years that I can remember. This was the first Sunday, as far as I know, in a long that she's not been here. And it was a pretty stark reminder of the reality of death. So if you know the McCaslins, you'll see information about the funeral for Gene that's going to be later this week. But just remember those three in your prayers and as you write notes. They could use your encouragement. I'm going to teach from Luke chapter 19. If you have your New Testament, we're talking about idols and how idolatry works in our lives. And so we're just going to go ahead and take on one of the toughest ones this morning by listening to how Luke describes Jesus' interaction with a very wealthy man. So here's what Luke says. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead, climbed a sycamore tree to see him because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up to him and said, "Zacchaeus, hurry, come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Jesus said to Zacchaeus, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." Cara and I were living in Detroit when the financial crisis of 2008 came to the United States. You might not know this, but about 12 to 18 months before it was felt in places like Nashville and Atlanta and Charlotte, the housing crisis hit Southern California, Detroit because of the auto companies, South Florida, and places like Las Vegas, Nevada. In fact, Cara and I were baptized into the risks of real estate. We had just purchased our first home in 2007. By the end of 2008, we had lost 50% of the value of our home. This was in suburban Rochester Hills. It's like the Brentwood of Detroit. There were stories in the coming months and years where houses in Detroit proper, historic houses that remind you of some of the most beautiful parts of East Nashville, were being sold for $5,000 and $10,000. So I know when I hear people in Nashville like, "Man, that housing crisis of 2008, I'm like, "You have no idea how bad it was." But what it did for me is it exposed how significant our identity is when we put it in property and possessions. And even as a young married person who didn't have a lot of money, maybe at that time we had $5,000 in the bank, maybe, it showed me how tight my grip already had become on the things I thought I could control. Tim Keller, who ministers in New York City, he was at the epicenter pastoring many of these people who were working on Wall Street in 2008. And here's what he says about the global crisis. He says, after the global economic crisis began in mid-2008, there followed a tragic string of suicides of formerly wealthy and well-connected individuals. The acting chief financial officer of Freddie Mac hanged himself in his basement. The chief executive of Sheldon Good shot himself in the head behind the wheel of his red Jaguar. A French money manager who invested in the wealth of many of Europe's royal and leading families, who had lost $1.4 billion of his clients' money in Bernard Madoff's Ponzi scheme, slit his wrists and died in his Madison Avenue office. A Danish senior executive with HSBC Bank hanged himself in the wardrobe of his suite at a posh hotel in London. The psychological toll of what happened in 2008 was greater than the financial toll. And I know, I've talked to you about some of this. Some of you saw your 401k or your Roth IRAs or your nest egg decrease by 30, 40, sometimes 50%. And you were faced with this stark reality of, "I've always said I don't put my identity in money, and I've always said I love God more than my possessions." But it's really easy to say that in our context, isn't it? Until things change like they did in 2008. I don't know how many of you watch HBO. I don't watch everything on HBO. I think some things are fascinating. But the three of the most popular shows right now on HBO are about money. Ballers, Succession, and I just forgot the third one. It'll come back to me by the end of the sermon. But it struck me over the last month or so as I was thinking about this particular teaching, how in America, we love those narratives about money. And here's what we love. This is the fundamental conviction that drives the dark side of our greed as people who live in the United States. The only thing that's better than money is more money. And that is a fundamental truth that drives so much of our obsession, so much of our work ethic, so much of our hopes and our fears and our worries and our conversations. When we are really honest, when we wake up at 2 a.m. sometimes and think about, have I saved enough? Have I done enough? All of that is a signal that we care about this thing called money way more than we would ever admit. So here's what I love about this story with Jesus. Let's go through this carefully. In verse 1, it says, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. So here's what Luke tells us. He tells us 3 things about Zacchaeus. First, he's a traitor. He's a tax collector. You know the background. He's standing between the Roman Empire and the Jewish people. He is a Jewish person, but he's no longer one of them because they're being taxed between Israel and Rome, 50 to 70% of their income. And these are the poorest of the poor in Israel. There's no middle class in the first century. So what little they have is being taxed. They're already living hand to mouth, wondering how they're going to make it, working 14-hour days, working the land, or in Jesus' case, traveling to Sepphoris with his dad to work on these stadiums as a stone or a wood mason. They're not flourishing. And Zacchaeus is part of that class of people that the Roman Empire has recruited to stand between the Roman Empire and his own people to say, you get money, and then when you're done doing that, get more. It's greed run wild. It's crushing. It's oppressing them. So Luke tells you Zacchaeus is a traitor. The word he uses for chief tax collector means he's the boss's boss. He's over all the other tax collectors, and he's rich. So he's a traitor. He's the leader of all the other traders, and he's made a lot of money off being a trader and the leader of the traders of the trader. He cannot be more disgusting for the people of Israel. Everything about him and what he stands for is repulsive. So, the story continues. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was so short. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry down and come down, for I must stay at your house. So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, he has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner. Now, in this part, Luke presents a little bit more human Zacchaeus. He's this man of intimidation, of influence, and of wealth. And in the midst of this, he wants to see Jesus, right? There's something about Jesus that's compelling. And so dignified men don't climb trees, right? Just like in the prodigal son, dignified men don't run towards their sons. Sons come to fathers. In the midst of that, he's dignified, but he's humble. There's something about Jesus that he wants to get close to. So he goes up into the trees like, I want to check this guy out. Now, you can guess how theologians and scholars have surmised and pondered why Zacchaeus is interested in Jesus. I think it's safe to say there's something about him that is compelling. Something about him which speaks to the truth that Zacchaeus knows he's missing something in his life. So Zacchaeus, this proud man, this rich man, wants to get closer to Jesus. He wants to understand Jesus. And then Luke tells us this. Jesus looks at Zacchaeus and he says, I'm coming to your house. I love this. I'm going to start doing this. Hey, I'm coming over for dinner tonight. Jesus just assumes that he would be accepted, right? We view that statement from Jesus through 21st century ears. In the first century, you were who you identified with when you ate at table. There's 10 food scenes in Luke, 8 which directly speak to this. So when Jesus says, I'm coming to your house, he's not just saying, man, I can't wait to have those filet mignons. What he's saying is, you're good enough for me to eat with you. I'll be seen with you. I'll be associated with you. I'll let people gossip. Did you know who he hangs out with? And the reason you know this is true is because in the very next verse it says, and when people saw that Jesus told Zacchaeus he was coming to his house, they began to grumble. Jesus, you can only eat with the preachers. Jesus, you can only eat with the Bible scholars. Jesus, you can only eat with the elders or the MCC or the youth minister. You can't go eat with a traitor. If you eat with him, you might as well be him. And Jesus knows, because you've read Luke, Jesus knows in the kingdom of God, all of those stereotypes get turned inside out, upside down. Because if the kingdom of God is not for everybody, then it's not for anybody. And we say that as church people. Jesus actually lived it. If the kingdom of God is not for even rich, disgusting, greedy people, then how can it be for anybody? Now listen to how this story ends. Then Jesus said to him, go back to verse 8. Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much. And Jesus said, today salvation has come to this house because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost. If you read the story carefully, when does Jesus ever confront him about his greed? When does Jesus say, hey, you know, I did a 6-part sermon series on this. You can get the live stream at facebook.ottercreek.org. You can, and you'll know what to do. When does he say, hey, actually, I have a bestseller book written about that. Have you read it? Just read the first 4 chapters. It will tell you everything you need to do to deal with your sin. We're not exposed to that conversation. All we know is that Jesus is intriguing and compelling to Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is aware that something's missing in his life, so he climbs the tree to see him. Jesus calls him out and says, you're good enough for me to eat with, even though you've done all these terrible things to all of these people who hate you. And when Jesus identifies him and deems him worthy of eating a meal and sharing a meal with in his own home, there's something about Jesus. Maybe it's something he's taught. Maybe it's something that's been passed down to Zacchaeus. But Zacchaeus just wants to give his money away. Like, here, preacher, just take it all. It's every preacher's dream. Just take it all. And Jesus says, today, salvation has come to this house. Now, if you're a Church of Christ or Baptist, Jesus got it wrong. I know the mic's messing up, but that's what I said. If you're Church of Christ or Baptist, doesn't Jesus get his theology wrong right here? Wait a second. Where's the sinner's prayer? He was not fully immersed, Jesus. He needs to go back to camp and he needs to do it again, because if he did, it didn't take. I don't know who baptized him, but it didn't count. Jesus says, today, salvation has come to this house. Why does Jesus say that? Jesus was starting something called the kingdom of God. He was not starting a denomination. He was not starting a university. He was not starting a parachurch ministry. He was not starting a small group. He was not starting a Bible study. He was starting a movement of people called the kingdom of God. And the purpose of the kingdom of God was to get people to be attuned to the Spirit of God. And when you're attuned to the Spirit of God, you want to live God's best. And when you want to live God's best, it means you've got to deal with the secrets and the idols that are in your heart. So the only way Jesus can get this person closer to God is to deal with his obsessions. And he doesn't say anything to Zacchaeus about lust or divorce or gossip, which we're getting to in a couple weeks. He says, Zacchaeus, you have an identity problem. You don't belong to anyone. And maybe you don't think you're worthy to belong to anyone. I'm coming
to your house. And when he does that, Zacchaeus says, take all my money. He doesn't even have to preach a sermon. He just says, I know what the Torah requires, and I'm willing to do more than what the Torah requires, four times if I have to. And Jesus says, salvation has come to this house. You now have a better story. You can see yourself in a better way. That's what it means to respond to God. So, of course, if it means praying the sinner's prayer, responding in baptism to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, of course we'll do it. But you get what the kingdom of God is doing. You have to change when God moves in your life. Because the Son of Man did not come to seek out and save, the Son of Man came to seek out and save the lost. So very practically, what I want to think about for just a few moments is how do we understand what it means to not serve God and money? Right? Scripture does not say you shouldn't serve God and money. Scripture says, you can't. Well, I'll just 80% love God and 20% worry about money. And Jesus says, you can't do it. You will be a slave to one, or you will be a slave to the other. In Colossians 3, in Ephesians 5, in Luke 12, the New Testament says that greed is idolatry. And here's what I wonder. I wonder why in 15 years of full-time ministry, people have confessed secrets, lust, addiction to shopping, addiction to food, addiction to sex, marital affairs, family secrets that have been passed down for generations, confessions about abuse. I've heard so many different things in the last 15 years, but not once has anyone ever confessed to greed. And we live in the richest country in the history of the world. And I just find that really interesting. So practically, what I've observed within Otter Creek are men and women who do this better than I do. Truly. And if they weren't so humble, I would just call them out right now, but then they wouldn't talk to me for a couple months, and I don't want to deal with that. But there are men and women in this church who are so generous financially. It is incredible and inspiring to me. And here's what they've taught me. Here's the first level of generosity. So generosity is the antidote to greed. You push back against the idol of greed and material possession. You push back against the only thing that's better than money is having more money. Level one is, hey, it's a command. And I love this about some of you. Some of you are givers because it's a command. It's in the Bible. The Bible says to do it. I'm not going to question it. I'm just going to do it. And God bless you for being that pure of heart that when Scripture says give with a generous heart, you just do it. And you just trust that God is smarter than we are. But that's just like elementary school. Middle school is duty or honor. This is my grandmother. I have one grandparent still living. This is how she views money, whether it's giving to the church or paying her taxes. This is so fascinating to me because I have a brother who's in finances and investment, and let's just say he's not wired that way, okay? Let's just call him Zacchaeus for a second. He's not here to defend himself. good thing no one else in this church works in that industry. I'm sure that wouldn't offend anybody by saying that. But my grandmother and my brother will talk about giving to the church and paying taxes. And my grandmother grew up dirt poor in northern Alabama. My brother did not. And my grandmother would say, to this day, Mabel Graves, she will say, it is an honor to give because it means I have something to give in the first place. Because she remembers a time when there was literally nothing to give. So when the church asks to dig water wells, she's writing the first check. When I decided to go to seminary, she wrote me a check every month to pay for my books. Because for her, it was an honor and a duty that came out of the whole idea of to whom much is given, much is expected. And that's how she views her taxes, by the way. And that would drive some of you crazy. The third example, the third level is, some of us give because it's a good example to our kids. right? You want your kids and your grandkids to think about this. You want them to be intentional. And some of you know Dave Ramsey so well, and you still get those envelopes out 30 years later, bless your heart, and you get the envelope Saturday night, and you write little Johnny's name on it or little Susie's name on it, and you bring them, your children or grandchildren to church, and they put those envelopes in the plate. And you might slightly give a judgmental look to those of us who pay online, but that's okay. We don't feel it. We don't receive that bad energy from you at all. But you want them to know you got to be intentional with your money. You got to think about it. You got to write it down. And you don't plan it at the end. You plan it at the beginning of the month. Are we giving $100 this month? Are we giving $500 this month? Are we giving $5,000? And you start with that. You write it down. And then everything else fits around that. As opposed to many of us in this church who are like, wait, how much do we have this month? Okay, let's do that. Level three of giving, of generosity, of pushing back against the idolatry of greed, is that you recognize how powerful it is when you set a good example. And you talk about it with your kids. And no, you're not getting MBA 2020, Lucas, because you have 2019, and you know what we can do with the $60 that would go towards 2020, you know, at Living Water, and you talk about it. Because, Lucas, it's not like you're missing out on much anyways. But then some of you go even deeper, and this is what I've learned the last 3 years from some very specific couples in this church, that actually giving is not just about command, honor, and being a good example. Giving is about the mission of God through the local church. And here's the hard part about Nashville. We have so many great things. But Jesus died for the local church. Jesus died for local people to be good news to the world. And parachurch ministries are great. All these other things are wonderful. But it all starts with the local church. When Jesus empowered Peter, he viewed men and women in local communities all over the world doing what we're doing. And you might think, this is the hope of the world you're looking at? Yes, this was God's idea as the hope of the world. And so part of what giving means is you first give your best to your local church. And that's something that Cara taught me when we were first married, because I was like, we could give to this thing, and we could give to this thing, and then the dogs come on TV, and they need an animal shelter, and I'm crying on Saturday, and it's like, we could give to that. And she taught me from the very beginning, first you give to your local church, and then you figure out what you can do. Well, what if I don't trust my local church? You need a new local church. That's next week. No, it's not. Level five, where Jesus goes with Zacchaeus, is that money is actually about the condition of your heart. All these other things are good, but it doesn't mean God has your heart. And I wish we could interview Zacchaeus to know, how did Jesus work his way into your heart? Because just by speaking an invitation to eat with him, solidarity, I'm with you, Zacchaeus said, take all my money. That's all he had to do. But it's about the quality of your heart. And this is what we learned last week about idols. Idols promise you something they can never deliver upon. So those of you who obsess with money, and you don't admit it to your church friends because you know it doesn't sound very spiritual, but you do. You think about it all the time. Those of you who obsess over money, has it added to the quality of your life? Has it actually done anything to bring you peace, this obsession? Jesus is in the business of removing these idols because he wants you to live with more purity of heart, with more compassion. Because what I know, even with sitting next to the bed of someone who died just 3 days ago, what I know is at the end, the only thing that matters are the people that you are connected to in your life, in your family, some of the people you're sitting by right now. Those are the only things that matter. And money is a giant distraction from being connected to all these people that you say you care about. And so Jesus loved Zacchaeus enough. He loved the rich man in another part of Luke, and he loved all these other people enough to tell them, look, your issue isn't sex. Your issue isn't nationalism. Your issue isn't gossip. But you do have one giant idol, and you might not be able to see it because the country you live in tells you not to question it. You are obsessed with money and having more. And it is like drinking salt water. You can never get enough. The New Testament assumed that the early church would believe that greed is idolatry. And so Jesus is coming for your heart. So if you're like, well, I'm not sure. I know I worry, but am I obsessed? I just want to ask you two questions. This is how I'm going to challenge you this week. First question is this. Do I spend too much time imagining how I could lose what I've worked so hard to acquire? There's so many great examples of this in Scripture that you think as you gain more, life will be better. If I just had that car, if I just lived in that neighborhood, if I just could fill in the blank. And then the truth is, once you acquire them, you actually have all the same struggles you did before. Now you just have more to worry about and more spreadsheets to check and more ways it could all go wrong. That's why a life of simplicity is so radical in our culture today. Do I spend too much time imagining how I could lose what I've worked so hard to acquire? If so, this might be one of the American idols you have allowed into your home. Second question, it's one of my favorite questions. Do I live with a scarcity or abundance mindset? Let me explain what this means. Here's scarcity mindset. There's only so much in the world. And I got to keep it as close to myself as I can because once it's gone, it's gone. And so I hoard and I keep and I save and I'm not generous and I don't take risks because I don't trust people and I don't trust institutions and I'm super suspicious. So I'm just going to keep it all. Abundance mindset says our very lives are a gift. Like even the fact that we, of all the human possibilities that could have been created out of the two people who came together to bring us into planet Earth, the fact that I'm here on planet Earth at this moment in time is a miracle. And this is God's world. And it's amazing to be alive in God's world. And there are lots of people with lots of things and lots of people with lots of needs. So it's not so much how much can I keep, it's together, we all have enough to take care of each other. How is the early church described in the early pages of Acts? They came together, they listened to the apostles' teaching, they broke bread, and they shared possessions as they had need. Because the early church understood in Rome, just like we should understand today in America, one of the most tangible ways we witness to the freedom that we have in Jesus is letting go of the slavery of money. And obsession and possessions, and to radically open our hands and to say, God, we give it back to you. We give it back to your people. We give it back to the people you love in the city of Nashville. We give this back to the homeless and the vulnerable and the broken and the poor and the disenfranchised and those who are struggling, because we don't need all of it. We've got enough. God, we trust that just as you brought us into the world and you bring us back to you in our death, we will have enough. There's enough for everyone to flourish. This is the difference of being a religious person and stepping into the kingdom of God. And sometimes the best place to hide from the kingdom of God is to be a religious person. Because you come right up to it and you look like you're going in, but then you just kind of hang out in the entrance. And Jesus says to Zacchaeus, salvation has come to this house today. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost, and there are 1,000 ways to get lost and 1,001 ways that Jesus will bring you back to being found. And I'm thankful that when Jesus became flesh among us, that he did not just seek the poor and he did not just seek those who were abused, but he also sought out rich, greedy people like me and like you. And there's something about Jesus that he says, look, together we really do need each other. The rich and the poor need each other for different reasons. This is what the whole Gospel of Luke is about. You need each other in friendship, in conversation, in practice, in imagination, in belief, in service, in forgiveness, in humility. You can't really fully experience the kingdom of God if you're just living in your own little area. And Jesus says, I'm coming to destroy all the idols, and the first one I'm going after, church in America, is your obsession with more. And the quality of your heart is intrinsically linked to your willingness to let go of that idol. And it's true, and it's true, and it's true whether or not you believe it. It's just true. So we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for these prophetic words from Luke. We give thanks, even though they're hard to hear, God. So would you open our hearts? Would you expose our hearts and everything that's in it? And God, for everything that I've said that is not from you, may it fall to the wayside. God, every word that I've spoken that is directly from you, may it plant seeds deep in the hearts of your children who are here this morning. And God, teach us to lean into Jesus' prayer and to teach us that we are bringing heaven to earth. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom.
Speak to me. You're the only voice I want to hear. Walk with me. Show me who you are as I draw near. If you're not in, then I don't want it. Let all else fade away. Take the whole world, but give me Jesus, and let all else fade away. Satisfy
Father, may we leave this place today as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to you. We love you. We thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Fears don't scare you. You're bigger than I. Your glory.